after the party, it's the Waffle House. If you ever been here, you know what I'm talking about. Where people don't dance, all they do is this. And after the original, you know what it is. Welcome to Atlanta Remix, hey. And we ride on them things like every day. Big beats hit streets, see gangsters roaming. And parties don't stop till 8 in the morning.
Welcome to Atlanta where the players play. And we ride on them things like every day. Big beats hit streets, see gangsters roaming. And parties don't stop till 8 in the morning.
Yeah. So our chapter, you know, we returned to NC State in 2017 and we obtained our charter in 2019. So we're still relatively fresh. And I pledged in fall of 2020. So I'm one of the older brothers and I've seen a lot go down. That's peak Zoom fall of 2020. That's probably where a lot of this loneliness and fear and where you don't want to go and experience that, put yourself in a vulnerable situation on campus. That's probably where a lot of that comes from for us college guys. But when I joined the chapter, we were at about 50, 60 men. And now we've grown to over 97 active members at the end of fall 22. So we had 23 initiated at the end of fall 22. It makes us the fifth largest fraternity at NC State. And we have a lot of alumni as well and a very active BOG board. And some of our alumni actually come and participate in our chapters from time to time. But, you know, we haven't gotten this far without our own fair share of problems. This rapid growth does not just happen, right? We've had to go through it, go through the thick of it. I'm looking at this photo here. I mean, all those people there have played a very pivotal role in making us what we are today. And the picture here is one of our past fraternity presidents on the far left is Matthew Penninger. He actually in my pledge class, straight out as a pledge, he, as soon as he was initiated, I mean, even before he was initiated, he was running for an executive position for VPAR. He ran for VPAR. And we really pushed that in our chapter. I see, like, we push our young members to you know, pursue executive positions, like leadership roles, so that way they can learn from a young, like a young age in our chapter, right? I mean, that's what our chapter is all about, is like trying to push you to grow personally and in our brotherhood. But unfortunately, we may have quite a few adolescent elephants amongst us, right? With these large numbers that we're bringing in, like I said, we had 23 in fall 22, and we were in the 20s, maybe 25 in spring 2022. We really wanted to grow our chapter and set ourselves apart on campus, and we pushed for more quantity, right? It's very hard to find that balance between quality and quantity, but we were testing the boundaries there, and we pushed for big quantity, and we bid a lot of guys, and a lot of them ended up coming on. Getting the chapter motivated is very difficult. How do you do that? We've had a retention rate of 96%, so not too many people leave. You know, our dues are relatively low on campus. That's one of our big selling features, right? Is we provide good value. We don't have a house on campus, but we're about to, a townhouse, a new construction right there in the middle of our Greek village. It'll be a wonderful addition, but at the cost of increasing our dues. We will all have a parlor fee, and it's like $150 or something for out-of-house brothers, and also a required meal plan is what it's looking like, just because of our university regulations. One thing that we've done since I've been a brother is we started to have brotherhood events, like specific brotherhood events, not just happen to be hanging out at the chapter house, but we have a guy that's specifically in charge of scheduling brotherhood events, like our chaplain. Our chaplain does brotherhood events, and we have one per month, and we encourage everybody to come out. It's like a cookout or, you know, golf or whatever you want. I'm big into the sporting clays. I'm trying to get that one on. But, you know, that's one reason why the brothers that do want to participate have formed a closer bond. But we also have a lot of participation and success in ISC. I don't have it on here, but like in the last several weeks or so, we like won everything across the board in the intramural sports. Just a lot of people love to go participate. We have a lot of athletes, even if they aren't like on the D1 teams at NC State, but we participate and dominate in the intramural. And that's where we get a lot of our pull from. Academics, we have a very strong scholarship chair. Like we put a lot of emphasis on that. It's in our pledging process as well, where you know, we have to hold people to a high academic standard. We try to give the associates every opportunity to do well academically. And you know, it's something that we advertise to the parents as well, that look, we're gonna make sure that they get enough study hours in to be able to succeed in school and also be an active participant in our brotherhood. And here's our stats as of recently. At Georgia Tech, I hear this is very competitive. You guys are at the 3.5, 3.6. Hats off to you. I don't understand. But our chapter, you know, we are consistently above average in the IFC arena. And compared to the campus body as a whole, we're pretty much on par. But our scholarship chair, they also put out like scholarships offered, and the brother with the highest, like the most improvement in their GPA gets some kind of a reward. So we have an incentive there to do well academically. And you know, each week our scholarship chair or an associate, they book study rooms in our libraries. So every day of the week, we have like 2 to 4 hours in a library, and we have 2 libraries on our campus, and both of them are always, you know, packed with Phi Tau. All right. Service is another big one. We have a whole like volunteer like committee, right? They put together all kinds of things. Carolina Tiger Rescue. That's a big thing. You can get creative with your service hours, right? Like we go to this big cat, like, I don't know what you call it. It's not a zoo, but it was like a rescue. And we help them out with everything that they need to do. These big cats require a lot of work, and they need someone to do it. And who doesn't want to go hang out with some tigers? I mean, it's amazing. And they're open to having us come back. And I mean, it's great. I'm sure at all of your chapters and universities, there's something unique in the area that would be open to having an extra helping hand. It's a great way to get service hours. We also do like street cleanups and you know, blood drives, things like that. We use a tracking service. It's like called Helper. Does everyone else do that too? It's Helper. So that's just an app where we can the NC State uses, where we can log all of our hours, and we can compare it to all the other different organizations on campus, and like we get to track everything. So that data driven decisions, you know, makes a big difference here. And we also have like a minimum service hours. I'm sure you guys all do as well. If you don't, you know, really encourage everyone to get some service hours in. It's a great way to build brotherhood, and you know, you're engaging in the community. And when people see Phi Tau out on the road picking up trash, I mean, that's like just a good view. Like, it's a good PR for your brotherhood. All right, so yeah, we can go on. Leadership. So yeah, there's a lot of ways to get involved in the Chi chapter. Like I said, we really push all of the young brothers to get involved as soon as possible. And you know, some people even run for exec positions, like Kevin John here, and my pledge brother Matthew Penninger, who ran for VPAR as an associate and he won. And right after that, he ran for president and he won that as well. And he was one of our better presidents that implemented all of these things. And he didn't do it alone, but it comes a long way. I mean, putting good people in leadership and really like supporting your leadership to where that they can, like, you know, they're just steering the ship, right? And they need a good support to be able to do that. And you know, I try and support the president as any way that I can, or anybody on exec board, like helping out. I'm just a brother, right? I've never ran for an exec position. I kind of regret that, honestly, but I have a lot of irons in the fire, if you know what I mean. And an exec position, I don't want to short my chapter by not being able to participate as much as I'd like to. But I do support the exec committee as much as I can. And you know, like I said, we have all kinds of committees and chair positions for the more important roles that just need to take place. One thing that you'll see on here that is pretty recent is a mental health chair. Mental health, I mean, it's been playing a big role on college campuses recently, as Dr. Bradley pointed out. And that's one thing that really drives our brotherhood, is to be open and vulnerable with each other. That's something that we really lack. So we implemented this to try and open people up a little bit more. And, you know, some people may be perfectly comfortable like speaking about their own personal lives and, you know, being vulnerable with their brotherhood. But I mean, these aren't just our friends or people that we go to chapter with. They're like our brothers, right? It's a step above a friend, right? Almost family, right? There are people that we should be able to open up to and like share whatever is on our mind with. I mean, you don't have to do it with the whole chapter, but like have some people that really support you and know what's going on, right? Like Dr. Bradley said, I mean, your Achilles heel, if you don't tell anybody what it is, I mean, that's one of the most stupid things you can do. because you're going to end up in a situation where someone might just find that and you have no one to support you to back that up. But on campus, I mean, we get very, very well involved, and I'll talk more about the mental health chair. So we actually survey our chapter. We put out things, anonymous surveys, right? So it's all anonymous. So 44% of college students, you know, this is just an average stat, just like Dr. Bradley said, you said 44.1, right? Have symptoms of depression and anxiety. But 75% of students who struggle with that depression are reluctant to get help. So what do you do? I mean, most people, they don't have that kind of drive in there to really reach out and get help about something so personal, right? Like, as a man, I feel like I should just be able to deal with it myself. But there's only so much that you can do with that. But we put in a mental health chair in that chapter every week. They talk about different opportunities that are available, all the resources that our campus has. College campuses have come a long way in terms of their support with mental health recently. And we make everyone aware of it every week, what's going on. And, you know, we have our mental health chair, and he's actively reaching out to people that maybe aren't being as active and just seeing what's going on. Like, is everything okay? And you need to check in with your brotherhood. And having someone that is very compassionate and really cares, have an actual position where he gets support in that way. I mean, it just makes for a good situation in your chapter. We really try and have all kinds of things just to ease the stress. Yeah, we just had a wiffle ball game a couple weeks ago. Yeah, chapter morale. That's probably a huge thing that our chapter can, like the kind of chapter personally, that we can improve on. In our chapter, we were having a problem right now where like the loudest person is the one that gets hurt, not the one that's most reasonable, right? And that's probably something that you guys all experience. But it's very difficult to get a handle on that and, you know, take back control. Something that we do at chapter, yeah, I want to talk about our like actual chapter meetings. You know, Phi Kappa Tau, what does it mean to be a Phi Kappa Tau? You know, we have all these things that we do. Before we even let you in the chapter room, we have our chaplain or someone on the exec board, we do our handshake, right? You have to do the handshake to get in the chapter room, right? So we practice that weekly. Sundays at 8, you show up and we're all waiting outside the room, and then we have to do the handshake to get in. And once we're in, I mean, everybody settle down. The exec gives a few announcements, but we say the creed at every chapter. I'm not sure how many chapters do that, but you know, we say the creed at every chapter. And at the end of every chapter, we do a gavel pass. So we literally just have a gavel, you know, like the sit and stand and things like that. But we pass the gavel all around the room to give someone an open opportunity to share what's on their mind. You know, people use that, and I'm so glad. I love a good chapter where pretty much everybody stops to say something. We put a ban on saying the Panthers won, let's go. no more anything like that. So, cause we just get repeated 10 times. But some of the real problems in our chapter have been surfaced at the gavel pass. That's something that's pretty sacred to me. And I appreciate the open forum to share whatever's on my mind or whatever I've witnessed at the chapter, whatever I have a problem with, whatever I want to celebrate, right? And share a success of mine. But if you don't have a gavel pass, I'd recommend that you implement something like that, because that really improves like my morale. This is one of the highlights of my week, honestly. And it makes me feel better to be a Phi Tau brother in my chapter. And I feel more connected and more willing to participate. I mean, the participation is difficult to get out of just your standard brother. If you take like the average brother, I mean, what is your participation level at? Maybe try and do some like internal analysis of what that looks like and see if it's at a good level, or maybe you need to make some changes. But that's where we're at. And I can keep on talking about what makes us great and like how to be a successful chapter. I mean, it's communication, right? Like the executive board, they have to have like proper channels to communicate and a drive to communicate their ideas and to push for their ideas. I mean, if you don't have an executive board that is steering the ship and it's just drifting off into the sea, I mean, what are you doing? It doesn't work. Thank you very much for having me. And there's my presentation. That's our Chi chapter.